Blackstone presents The Easy Way Out by Stephen McCauley. This book is read by Josh Hurley. For Lupus. Part 1. 1. 4.5 months before his wedding, my younger brother called me from Chicago at 1 in the morning. I'd been having a nagging problem with insomnia for about 5 years, so I was always thrilled to hear the phone ring, the smoke alarm sound, a picture fall from the wall, or anything that gave me an excuse to get out of bed. On that particular night, I'd been thrashing under the covers since the end of the late news, scratching my armpits and bouncing my legs, all quietly enough to leave my lover Arthur's sleep undisturbed. At the sound of the phone, I leapt up, ran into the living room, tripped over a pile of clothes, and picked up the receiver. As soon as I heard Tony's voice, I mumbled something about having been asleep. With my younger brother, I try to grab the advantage immediately.
"I'm sorry, Patrick," he said. "Do you want me to hang up?"
I pretended to think it over for a few seconds, and then, always magnanimous, said, "Don't bother. I'm awake now." I was actually delighted to hear from Tony. He almost never called me anymore, and when he did, I was just dumb enough to be flattered by the attention. Tony is exactly the kind of loud, right-wing bully I feel obliged to take a stand against on principle, but from whom I secretly crave approval. He's taller than me, broad-shouldered, and at the time of the call, he was living 1,000 miles from home. He's never been quiet about the fact that he views my life with mild disdain. I'm not as handsome as he is. I'd gone from teaching school to being a travel agent.
An even bigger loser profession.
I hadn't supported a single winning candidate since the day I registered to vote, and my sex life was considered reprehensible by every candidate who did win. For my part, I consider myself smarter than Tony, but I suspect he has more common sense. In any case, he only called when he had a problem he wanted to discuss, usually something profoundly meaningful, like a lost airline ticket or a hotel reservation botched by his secretary, and I loved feeling like an older brother, with age and experience, and some advice worth listening to. He didn't say anything for a minute. And then, irritably, he asked,
"So, what's been going on?"
"Don't expect me to supply the news," I told him. "You're the one who dialed the phone."
"I guess that's true," he said,
and then lapsed into silence. Since late January, my mother had been calling me with unusual and disturbing frequency and feeding me a lot of unfinished sentences that had something to do with Tony.
"That brother of yours,"
she'd say dolefully.
"What's wrong with Tony?" I'd ask.
It had to be Tony. Ryan, my older brother and only other sibling, was generally referred to as either the saint or that poor slob.
"Who said there was anything wrong? Why does there always have to be something wrong? My God, Patrick, I was just wondering if Tony..." "Oh, never mind. You wouldn't understand."
Whether I'd understand or not, I was eager to fill in some of the blanks for myself, but I knew I'd have to play along with that brother of mine if I wanted to get any information out of him. Like my father, Tony could be astonishingly circumspect, a trait I admired as a sign of masculinity and lack completely. I reveal my most intimate secrets to any innocent bystander who will listen. I told Tony I was planning a trip to Egypt in May, a travel agent's junket, and that I was thinking about buying a new car. Both intimate secrets were lies, but Tony loves to give advice on automotives, and I always try to make him think I live a glamorous, globe-hopping life. He made a disparaging comment about the Egyptian military and launched into a nonsensical tirade against all foreign cars. I was lying on the antique sofa in the living room, naked, under a scratchy afghan. It was early in March, and winter, which had been regrettably mild that year, was doing me the favor of lingering on in the form of chilly nights. The air felt icy and sharp, and the living room was filled with faint blue light from either the moon or the street lamp below. Through the tangle of hideous Swedish...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.